Oh, it's gone again.
It's hiding behind.
Oh, it is?
It's back there.
In the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Can we do a roll call, please?
Ms. Blanco?
Here.
Mr. Martinez?
Here.
Dr. Sanchez?
Here.
Mr. Mason?
Here.
Ms. Chavez?
Here.
And then report on closed session, we have nothing to report. Is there a motion for the adoption of the agenda?
So moved, adjourned.
I'll second that.
Aye.
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 I don't see any comment cards, right now we have public comment for items that are not agendized. I'm not seeing any public comment cards for the non-agendized items. So we'll move on to the reports, the superintendent's reports first.
I just wanted to share with the board a couple of important dates.
Okay.
Through the work of YouTube and San Bruno Chamber of Commerce, they have sponsored a meet and greet with me on September 3rd at the Senior Citizens Center, and very gracious to accept that opportunity to be a part of your community and meet the folks that come to your school every day. So that's happening on September 3rd from 6:30 to 8:00. And then again on September happy to report that we have hired two incredible candidates to fill these coaching positions at Allen and Bel Air. In fact, one of them is a current kindergarten teacher at Allen, Ms. Megan Dido. I think I said that wrong. This year will be our second year of SEAL implementation and will include the participation of our second and third grade students, teachers, not the students, but the students who participate too, from Bel Air and Allen. Our TK through first grade SEAL teachers will continue their learning and the refinement of their unit plans during this upcoming year. We were able to hire one in-house PE teacher for elementary schools and work to develop a schedule that would support these two sites in collaboration with Ms. Karen Byrne, who is our union representative. And we will continue to utilize rhythm and moves to support PE for first through fifth grade classes at John Muir and Portola and Rollingwood. Although we were unable to fill our elementary music teacher position, we will continue to contract with Music for Minors to provide introductory music education for all students in grades TK through 5. This upcoming Monday, we'll kick off the new year with a welcome back breakfast and ceremony. Through the generosity of YouTube and Google, we'll provide our district staff with a hearty breakfast from Nueve. Recology of Sam Bruno has generously provided some gifts that will be used in an opportunity drawing during our welcome back day. During this day, teachers will participate in a variety of sessions, including topics such as NGSS instruction, developing inclusive schools, and supporting literacy through mathematics. Chris Carroll, our behavior supervisor, and Ellen Merritt, our interim director of SPED, have been instrumental in helping to develop the agenda and sessions for Plan A, B, C, all the way to Z, based on our limitations right now. This is something that we're very proud of, that in order to maximize instructional time for our teachers, particularly our kindergarten teachers, during the beginning of the year, we began assessing our students who for English language proficiency during the summer. This is the first time this has ever happened, where the students began assessment before school, and this will really help us to maximize the time that students are spent in class. Under the leadership of our educational assessment and data tech, staff members Kristen Cummings, Minnie Lopez, and Paula McAndrew were able to assess more than half of our potential English learners. So that's going to be fantastic when we get back to school. I'm also very happy to announce that all of our textbooks have arrived at their school sites. So William's act, here we come. Yes, thank you. As you see along the walls, they're all here and ready to be given to our students. This year, in the summer, has been so rapid, I can't believe it's already done. And I'm looking forward to another great year with our board and our teachers and staff.
Thank you, Dr. Rogers. Exempting district projects from local zoning ordinances. Is there a motion to approve?
To the chair, so moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there a roll call for discussion?
Yes, I have a question for legal counsel. I noticed section 2A. Essentially, the district can and hereby does exempt itself from and renders itself inapplicable to the projects and school site any zoning ordinances of City of San Bruno, including without limitation the City Municipal Code and the City's General Plan. Does this include the heritage tree policy of the City of San Bruno?
I'm not sure. I would have to take that back and look into it a little bit further to see what waiving the ordinance is may or may not affect as far as heritage trees.
Thank you. I, given the light of that information, and it's not currently available, I'm actually prepared to ask my colleagues if we want to table this item and gather more information on the zoning requirements.
Are you proposing a motion?
I'm just asking my colleague if it would be. I'd like to make a motion that we table this to gather more information to a later date. Someone has to say.
So, well, second, we can have a discussion.
Sounds good.
I was actually hoping that Mr. Mason would explain why he wants to wait. It could be that he's worried that it does exempt it from the heritage tree, and he wouldn't want that to happen. But of course, even if you were exempt from the heritage tree for exempting this, you could still not cut the trees down. I mean, you're not saying we're going to cut down all the trees even if we're exempt from the heritage tree. I would think that would be a policy decision you would want to make when you find out whether or not you have any possible need to cut down the trees according to what the district needs, not according to what the city heritage tree ordinance wants. You can say the same thing about anything else in the zoning ordinances that, well, we don't want to. No, you're allowed to be exempt from the ordinance because you're a school district. And I don't think you should give any of that back ahead of time. You may decide not to, but I don't think you want to have your motion say, we're not going to cut down any tree on any of our properties we're working on that might be a heritage tree because we are putting ourselves to that one issue back in the city's bailiwick. You don't want to do that. If there is, because the tree you're thinking of may be one that the board would like to say, but there may be a whole bunch of other trees. For instance, I'm thinking, we have an awful lot of eucalyptus around, but I don't really need every single one of them. But if we say that we're going to put ourselves under the city's jurisdiction on that, under the Heritage Trees Act, if there's one tree you want to save, well then when the time comes up to deal with that, or 100 trees you want to save, deal with it amongst your colleagues here. Not by putting us under the city's jurisdiction on that issue. Thank you.
For the chair, given the light of public comments, for me it's a lack of information. I love data. I like understanding exactly what are we opting out of. So I'm sure there are reasons for city zoning and county zoning. The reason why I asked the legal counsel is I want to better understand exactly what we're opting out of, and I think that's a fair assumption. And I welcome my board colleagues on that. Thank you.
Good chair, if I could jump in for just a minute. It's very common for school districts when they're going through construction to exempt themselves from city and county ordinances. We're not exempting ourselves from fire, life, and safety. Okay? Those things still fall in the city. But when we are going through construction projects, the school districts are under the division of state architect that has rules and regulations regarding schools that are above and beyond what you would normally see with cities and counties. What you don't want is to have multiple layers of bureaucracy where they conflict. And so when we get to the point of construction, school districts often exempt themselves from city ordinances except for fire, life, and safety. If there's a concern that you have about, in this case, the heritage trees, that's something that you can work in direct with superintendent to work with staff to make sure that we are honoring or respecting whatever that ordinance is. You don't have to table this.
whatever the San Bruno ordinance is, you know, for trees, if we can deal with that without changing anything that we have here. And then in terms of schools, I can give you a couple of examples of schools that have gone through this process. Castro Valley Unified School District, which is across the Bay Area, they passed, I believe, $128 million bond, and they exempted themselves from county ordinances and city ordinances as well. Because I'm really relatively new to San Mateo, I don't really have examples here. We also look at Hayward Unified, Pleasanton Unified, we also look at Oakland Unified, as examples of districts that have gone through this process as well.
Through the chair, thank you for the added comments, ma'am. That's excellent. For me, it's a sticking point that we've never actually had a subcommittee. You're here. We've actually never had a subcommittee with the city leadership as a board. And so this object of the city zoning, the city itself, city San Bruno, might say, you guys are all the government, but you know, so is this a common practice?
It is a common practice. It's very common. Like I say, fire life and safety still go through the local ordinances, you know, the local fire department,
chair, to be blunt about this, you, if the subcommittee came to the city and told where you could work all that out, correct, as far as like heritage tree policy and whatnot?
We don't do that when it comes to construction. We don't want to add in extra layers of bureaucracy, because if you have projects, for example, with your GO bond, you have timelines and deadlines that you want to meet. You have a part of time getting those projects through the division of the city.
Tabling is the one.
Dr. Camber, just to clarify the statements, the bottom line is not about endangered species and whatnot. The bottom line is that we have not had any subcommittee meetings with the city, which would be great if we could start to scale those with the board.
Well, this wouldn't be an item that we would talk to the city about, because this is just a routine item for us to get going on our projects. So sitting down to talk to the city about this would really be adding layers of time and money and energy to a project we don't need to do.
Not so much this zoning, not to discuss this zoning resolution with them, but to say, when we rebuild our schools, we have a number, look at the back of Parks, and there's like 150 trees back there. Some of them are giant. We don't have protected in some way through heritage tree ordinance or whatnot. I mean, we're gonna lose it.
Well, and I think the gentleman that spoke at the podium is right. You control what you do and the footprint you leave when you work the strength of the projects. Anything that's going to be done will come to the board for approval, and a project that will be presented for cost and time and resources needed. And it's at that time that you would say, wait a second, we want to be able to ensure this, and that would be included in the bid that goes out for the job.
And we could build in a heritage tree policy or a heritage tree.
Absolutely, whatever the board.
Within that.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Through the chair. Andy, I think, I'm not sure if it's correct, I'm wrong, but I think I hear you say, that we just said it's very general zoning ordinances, and the fact that we're not really well-versed or aware of what those ordinances are, that you would feel more informed with knowing what these ordinances are. And to be honest with you, I agree with Andy, we have yet to meet with the Joint Advisory Committee, which is comprised of two board members, that usually is the board president, vice president, and two city council members, and the superintendent and the city manager. So I would just ask that, if just moving forward, approve this resolution, schedule a meeting, we're supposed to meet with them quarterly anyways, so we will move forward, schedule the meeting with them, you and Terry can go meet with them, and Javon, and whoever the city designates those two city council members are, and bring this up so that you feel that you have the information and the knowledge about what the local zoning ordinances are.
Fantastic. I like your approach. Thank you. Fantastic.
So are you good, Andy?
I'm good. Let's proceed with the rest of it.
Let's say thank you, Dr. Camber, and Dr. Clark, and Mr. Crowley for explaining that we can ask questions about the process, and also particularly what trees we were discussing. I also want to mention Dr. Candy Clark. She is our interim CEO, for those that don't know. So welcome.
Welcome.
To the chair, point of order. Regarding the disposition of the district surplus property located on the Engvall site. The purpose of the RFP is to provide the board with options so that we can make informed decisions on whether to lease or sell the property, or even a hybrid approach. As elected officials, we are tasked with oversight of San Bruno's public school students, kindergarten through eighth grade. The board's decision about disposition of the property will ultimately be based on what is best in the best interest of children we serve now and in the future. We cannot make that decision unless we are informed of both options. Tonight's agenda item is not a decision to sell or lease. We are approving the request for proposal. The reason why I want to state that is because I know that there's been some communications on social media, and I want to make this clear that we're not voting on selling or leasing tonight. We're voting on the issuance of the RFP, the request for proposal. And I'd like to open this up if there's any board members that would like to have any discussion.
I have a written statement I'd like to read to the chair. Dear board colleagues, given the resolution tonight, I'm prepared to vote no based on the following reasons. One, the uniqueness of the site. The site is within the most coveted geographies in the San Francisco Bay Area. We are adjacent to the San Francisco Airport and near 101 and 280 Freeway. We're just a mile south of San Francisco, one of the most innovative and interesting city destinations in the United States. In addition, the Engvall Site also borders the ecological site of the Crestmore Canyon, San Bruno City property, as well as easements with Caltrans. Number two, general fund money, essentially lease income, which would be preferable, can provide the district an estimated $2+ million in terms of general fund revenue for the district. It can be used for teacher salaries. It'll be ongoing revenue for academic programs, portion to graduate. It also can be used for general fund money. So it can be used for facilities upgrades if needed, and they are desperately needed across the district. Communication from 2017 until today, I've asked senior staff and superintendent, not Dr. Cameron, you're exempt on this one, but I've asked for subcommittees with the city to discuss the best options, the best overall community benefit for the site. And to be frank, to my dismay, these meetings have not been scheduled. These valuable meetings could build consensus across our two governing bodies about zoning, about community benefits, garnering input from citizens. Basically, we passed a bond we're all proud of, and it's all about checks and balances in government, and we're proud of that. But I think that this site is 21 acres. It's really too large. I believe that the RFP, and I don't want to stonewall the project. I want to stonewall a renovation, but I believe the RFP should only have lease language in it at this time. Thank you.
YouTube, for what they're doing over Bayville, has paid the city
in fees and support costs up $2 million. You're going to need somebody who can put in a similar commitment if we want to do something amazing in Engvall. And you just said to the city, hey, we want to be exempt from your ordinance, we want to change it, we're going to get banned. Not interested. Look at the process they went through for years on the transit board. So yes, we need to do it, but it's not this thing today that we need to table. We do need to hear what's out there and what people are saying about it. What people who are in the business of buying properties like that want to do. So we can go to the city and say, hey, look, this is what we're getting. Are you kidding me? Now, on the other hand, I would never say never. If somebody came and told me, gosh, you know, we want to buy that thing for $250 million right now, well, I might be tempted to sell it even though I can think of other things I want to do. But I don't expect that. I don't expect to think Tom's going to get that. But hey, we'll talk about that if that ever happens. Don't even need to sell any more bonds. So we need to, the board needs to sit down, the district needs to sit down with the city. YouTube's already involved. Google is making big noises about how they want to help local communities with their zoning fights in order to move the process along. We've got all those Google people, YouTube people who are involved in the city, they know the planners. Let's start working with something. Get Kevin Mullen's office involved. I don't know what the process has to do with it, but do exactly what you want to do, but pass a resolution and then figure out how to really make that happen. And if we get nothing, then we say no. We don't sell it. We're not in any hurry. I would wait 20 years before I longer, but go ahead and do the RFP and find out and start working on the process. We're really turning that into what will be the best for the district in the long run. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Carney. We have another comment card from Ms. Linda Mason.
Sale on the RFP only to come back with
Cervantes?
I just heard about this issue a few days back, and I really urge everyone to consider Linda had mentioned in that it's a simple case of once you sell the cow, you're not getting any more milk out of it. You know, it's as simple as that. The peninsula's not growing any more land. It's very, very limited resource that's not going to increase anymore. If you look at it in a long-term way, if you sell it, that money's going to be spent and it's going to be gone. If you lease it, at least you still have it, just in case all the high-density housing is being built, but also result in an increase in students, because there may be singles, folks that are moving in, or young married couples, but the students are going down, obviously. And so, at least there's some option of having some benefit from that land for those students in the future, in whatever way is possible, with an ongoing cash flow coming from the lease. And as Linda mentioned, you can always turn around if you're still interested after seeing what you see from the lease. You can always turn around to another EFP who includes sale or expiration. It just makes perfect sense. The land is so precious. And when will you have the opportunity or the money to buy more land if you need it? So it's too precious to let go in this way. So that's my point.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
We can progress with prudent steps, but that market out there will start to $79 million bond. You can't go out and reorganize the district again. We don't have that, so now we have other assets. We used the Carl Sandburg money in a very strategic way, and we were sold when we were in the Great Recession in the early 2009, 2010, the district would not have survived and had not had those assets already there. So it becomes important that you want to use the assets in a critical way, and it's going to benefit students not only today but the future. So I think having a very broad perspective and looking at the options is critical for our role as trustees of the school district or any school district, and you just take.
Leasing it is fine, depending on who you lease it to, and depending on who makes up the contract for that lease. Right now, we haven't had a golf course on this property that is a nightmare. In the last year, we have received 3 violations of code, and that for things that are going on down there, because of the way our contract is written. This has become a situation. They come down, he subleases out the parking spaces to two people in trailers who are living there. He's subleased it to bus companies and limousine companies who are parking down there, and they take up all the space. The fire marshal came down and saw all these buses, 37 buses lined up in a row. If they caught on fire, there was no way for a fire truck to get down there. And you've been to the site, you've seen the access. If you lease this property, and then depending on how you sit there and set up the contract. Right now, we're the ones who receive the violation codes because it's our property, and the way it's worded in the contract, we are the ones responsible for allowing him to do what he's doing. So, selling the property or leasing it is fine, but do it responsibly and make sure that of how everything is worded when you do it.
Any further comments from the board? So I just want to clarify tonight's agenda. It was not a decision to sell or lease. We're being requested to approve the requested proposal. And I would like to say that I agree with what you were saying. I agree with everyone's comments. It would be, I think, instead of having multiple RFP processes, though, it would be nice to have one RFP, one requested proposal, and then receive responses for leasing the land and also receiving responses for proposals to purchase the land. It would be nice to make a full decision based upon all responses. So if we're ready to go through with the vote, I think we've already motioned for the vote.
Yes.
So should we do a roll call vote?
Ms. Blanco?
Aye.
Mr. Martinez?
Aye.
Dr. Sanchez?
Aye.
Mr. Mason?
No.
Motion passes 4-1. The next action item is the TOSA job description. District PD and induction coordinator.
Program in-house and providing our own mentors that cuts that cost in half. So it would contractors to provide professional development, we would be able to utilize the talent within San Bruno Park School District. And ask the chair for this position.
Through the chair, so moved.
I have a question. SBA president is here, and I just want to hear from her regarding this position.
Sorry, do you want me to come up? I absolutely can.
No.
Sorry, go there. Dr. Rogers reached out to me last week. I know I usually email, sorry, there's been some connectivity issues, but they're doing a great job. It's great. It's fine. So, but she reached out to me, and we met last week, and we are excited, actually, to anytime we can bring things back in-house and not contract out to the county and pay our own people to do things. I think our staff will get better support, more curtailed support, so I'm super excited to work with Dr. Rogers on that.
Thank you. So the next item is a discussion item for the board policy, regulation 6142.1.
For the chair. So Terry and I, Public Education, Terry and I sit on the board policy committee. This board policy is probably the most interesting one we've covered. I've received a lot of input from a number of people outside of the board meeting. It's really important implementation-wise, that we have something in writing communicating to parents in the ability to opt out of a certain section of the program. It showed people actually how to opt out or how to opt in. And again, this is all ed code, and I just think the board policy committee, you and I,
right,
should probably bring this back as an item. I want to hear my colleagues' input on this as well.
And any other comments?
That's okay.
I'm having a water issue here. I was just going to ask a question. Just table it and have it go back to work to the.
That's exactly what we're saying.
Okay,
yep.
Okay, great. But also, if you all can have a conversation with Denise, I can later do with Denise. For sure, what came the night that we hired Sharon spoke, there was some concerns. So if you all can. I have spoke with her. I think maybe the more, it's going to be judged. And she sent us an email. Her number, I forwarded an email. I don't know if you or Andy forwarded it to Sharon, but I forwarded it to Sharon. And her number's at the bottom of the email, Sharon.
Thank you very much.
So, Trustee Missy, you made a motion to table this item?
Yeah, absolutely.
So, is there a second? Second. What did you want to say something?
So, I guess the only comment I want to make was that the. And I should go back to it, but what I was hearing a lot of was about the how things would be done, which in policy language would be in the administrative regulations. So I would just ask that you spend the bulk of your time on the board policy board for the board policy, but it's on the administration for regulations for how to implement it. So especially when it comes down to the how issues, I'm sure what you'll come up with would be good questions, but I think it's with trust that the regulations will come through the work and experience of the administration in how to implement those things that arise from board policy itself.
Thank you.
Through the chair. I don't think tabling is going to resolve the issue. I think we already have policy in place in terms of students talking out the policy and the parents having that. I think the issue of health awareness, especially in the community, like HIV and other HPV, you know, that whole environment has become very important to understand the social responsibilities and issues and resurgence of these diseases. And vaccinations are important, especially they come in light, that become very important that they understand. Because I think people don't realize that there are always some beliefs that are trying to opt out of things, but making the detriment, just like people that are anti-vaccine, the consequences it has in various states where new diseases are flourishing because of this and causing more maladies and harm to the children and the community. So I think it's how, like any type of curriculum, it's how you construct it in a way that it doesn't become so what people would consider sexualized, but being down to the biological nuances and how diseases are transmitted, and put it in a way that's very educational, fun, and understandable, so that they, as young adults, going into the world, understand the consequences. And I think you can opt out, but the issues are not going to go away out there when you have to engage the world. Sandra is one microcosm, or even there's a microcosm. But the rest of the world is moving forward. These diseases can be transmitted within 24 hours. You can catch a plane, and they can be transmitted in the city, in this country, and in this world. And so we have to be cognizant of the public health issues. So I don't think tabling is going to be the issue. The issue is how people are trying to understand how it gets mechanized in terms of popping out. I would promote opting in rather than opting out, because it will be the welfare of the children that are at stake for the funds for.
Can I just clarify that there has been a question about how it's been done historically? I agree with Trustee Martinez and Trustee Sanchez and Trustee Mason. There are needs to look at policy only simply because we need to clarify the AR in the way that it's presented. We had some missteps last year, and I think this will just give us the opportunity to reassure our community that we're listening and hearing their concerns, and that we will have protocols in place that address their concerns. And I will work with Dr. Rogers to make sure that that's happened to the satisfaction of the board before we bring it back for second reading.
Chair, thank you very much. It's very thoughtful. Appreciate it.
An amendment to the report. According to the Brown Act, we can amend personnel report is allowable due to the urgency of meeting the needs of the special ed students that we have in our district. Our schools, as you know, our school's starting next week. So we are adding a person to the personnel report, the director of special education and student services, and that is Anita Aladars.
Aladars.
Thank you. She's right in the front row. So we want to add that to the, that's the personnel report, and then we're amending it to add in Anita Aladars. Right, and we do need to vote on that separately.
Could the chair make a motion?
Amended, or making a motion to amend it?
Amended and to approve.
Right. Okay, so all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any votes? So five?
We need two.
We're not going to vote.
Congratulations.
Welcome. Okay, so we'll go through the rest of the consent items.
So I know there's supposed to be an update on the virtual version of the language program at Parkside. Did we receive an updated June on that? As far as enrollment goes, I think that'd be a great opportunity for an agenda item.
I'm glad you said that. We had intended on bringing that back as a report in September. We failed to do so.
Okay, fantastic.
Little cars down there that you leases to Uber drivers.
And on future meeting days, Wednesday, September 11th is a regular board meeting at Parkside. Wednesday, October 9th is a regular board meeting right there at Allen at 7 p.m. And with that, I guess we are adjourned from the meeting. 8:07. Thank you. Thank you for all the public comments and speakers as well.